Mrs. Ishmael.
Thank you, Violet. Welcome, friends, to this meditation workshop. Today is just going to be an introductory lecture to introduce you to the subject, but the next 2 days will be the real stuff, when we do practically what we always talk about. The spiritual science is a very practical science like all sciences. It is no different than any empirical science. People think that this is just a subjective experience. It may be a subjective experience, but the rules and conditions for study of spirituality are about the same as for any science. Indeed, when I was at Harvard University, a professor of applied psychology, who claimed he was a scientist, questioned how I could call the spiritual path a science. Because he said, in science, we have controlled conditions for experiments. The results are made public, published in books. And there's an empirical veracity to the results so that people can all see, and the results are repeatable. Do these conditions apply? And I said, certainly, the same conditions apply to practice of spiritual science. The fact that you have set up a laboratory up in the building on the 6th floor of your building, which was indeed the case, in the science building in Cambridge, the science lab for applied clinical psychology was on the 6th floor. I said, the fact that you have an outside building you call your lab, and a spiritual practitioner has an inside building on the 6th floor in the physical body behind the eyes, should make no difference. It's still a lab. It is still an experiment that we are doing. He said, but we do have very, very closed conditions. We have windows shut down. We don't allow outside air to come in. We have equipment, machinery to measure things. And we control everything. I said, so is the spiritual practice of meditation controlled the same way? We sit down, allow the body to be absolutely steady. We close the eyes, the windows of the 6th floor chamber on the top of this body, human body, and we conduct experiments exactly like you do. And we publish the results. There are thousands of books published on the results of spiritual practice. Many people have declared that they have had the same experiences. What's the difference? The empirical rules that apply to science also apply to spirituality. But just because some voodoo stuff comes in once in a while and claims to be spirituality, doesn't mean that spirituality itself is not a science. The spiritual path continues to be a science, in spite of the fact that some people who are practicing various kinds of other practices they call spiritual. For example, psychic experiences are not spiritual experiences, but sometimes people dub them as spirituality. For example, various kinds of yogas with the physical body, putting the body in various kinds of asanas, various kinds of positions and postures, they call it a spiritual practice. That is not a spiritual practice. These practices were adopted by people who wanted to practice spirituality. For example, if you study how the various positions and postures of yoga were adopted, you will find that these were positions of the body adopted for practice by those who were meditating in small caves. They found little small places in which they placed themselves, and they did not do jogging for exercise. They did not go on a treadmill. They had no clubs to go to practice their muscles. They had to do all this in a very small space. The 84 positions prescribed by Patanjali in his books on yoga all specify that those exercises which can help you to exercise all the muscles of the body can be performed in a very small space. And that's how these came up. Now, to call something that is making your body fit as a spiritual practice would be a misnomer. Of course, it is used by people who practice spirituality, but does not by itself become a practice of spirituality. Similarly, psychic phenomena, like having an out-of-body experience, by projecting the heart chakra and having an experience outside of yourself, may be a great experience in expression of energy in the body, but does not amount to spirituality. I came here in the 60s and found there was a big practice of psychic experiences going on, which people thought were spiritual exercises. The psychic experience is an experience of the energy system in the body. The body is controlling all the energies through six chakras, six centers of energy that lie below the eyes. The highest chakra of energy lies behind the eyes. So all these chakras of energy, which operate in the physical body and perform various functions, they distribute the energy, they create the frequencies necessary to keep the balance of the body and balance of emotions, balance of passion, balance of the five so-called vices. These energy centers are controlling the human body, but they do not touch the spirit at all. That is why to call a practice of any kind by any name a yogic practice that deals only with these six centers cannot be called a spiritual practice. The science of spirituality requires that you deal with the spirit, not with the body. Indeed, some people think that mind control might be a spiritual practice. They do not realize that the mind is only an accessory to the spirit and is not the spirit. The mind has been designed in the human body, in the human frame, in order to hold memory, in order to transfer memory from one body to another, in order to hold all the Akashic records that contain our destinies, in order to play out those destinies in human life, to play out through the five senses all the experiences of perception outside. It's a great machine given to us. But to experiment with that machine and to say it's a spiritual practice is again a misnomer. Spiritual practice can only be truly spiritual if it deals with the spirit, with the soul, with the consciousness of a person, with that which makes a person alive, that which makes a person a spiritual person. These mental exercises are good for the mind, but they do not qualify to be called spiritual practices. Then what exactly is a spiritual practice? A spiritual practice, scientific spiritual practice, or the science of spirituality would be to discover the spirit in its entire naked form without the covers of the mind, senses, and the body. If you are able to discover that, you are practicing the science of spirituality. And if you are doing anything else, these are different exercises to exercise the body, exercise senses, exercise the mind. They do not qualify to be spiritual practices. Now, in order to discover the spirit, we should know what spirit is. Spirit is our life. Spirit is our consciousness. Spirit is what makes this body move. Spirit is what makes the senses work. Spirit is what makes the mind work. Spirit is what generates love, beauty, joy, intuition in our experience. That is spirit. If we don't have this definition of the spirit, we go wrong right from the beginning in understanding the science of spirituality. That is why it is said, if you know yourself, your real self, you are practicing the science of spirituality. Socrates said, know thyself. And he called it a spiritual practice. He was right, because we don't know who we are. We think that the covers upon ourselves are ourself. We think this body, physical body, that covers our living consciousness inside is ourself. We think that because we have sensory perceptions, because we can see, touch, taste well, therefore these sensory perceptions are ourself. We consider that because we can think and we can communicate by thinking, because we can speak, because we can write, that is ourself. And none of these things is the self. These are covers upon the self. The self is the motive force that makes all these work. Consciousness drives all this equipment, and the equipment works exactly like a scientific equipment. You will notice that the physical body that covers all these internal covers of ours functions to create a physical material experience outside of ourselves. The material world would not be there if we didn't have a material physical body. The physical body generates the experience of a physical world around us. If we were to leave this physical body, as we all leave, we all come into physical bodies and we all leave, we all die. Somehow, a notion exists in our mind that everybody else will die, we have a little more time. When the last moment comes, we find we had no time at all. And that is why we miscalculated how long we will be here in the body. Actually, we should be prepared all the time that this body is going to go. Everybody has left the body. The greatest scientists have left body. The greatest masters have left body. Great master left body. Nobody kept the body forever. And therefore, to believe that the body is that immortal self that we are supposed to be, that is referred to in all the scriptures, that we are immortal, and to consider a temporary body to be that immortal self is a great mistake. Then if this body is not ourself, but creates the physical experience around us, how does it do that? How does a physical body create an experience? We are led to believe, because of the reality of the body, that because this body is real, and is not a cover, we believe all the experiences that come through this body must be real. So we take all experiences around us as real. We think the whole world is real. Explored, unexplored, seen, unseen, thought out, any kind of world around us which we are experiencing while in the physical body must be equally real, because we believe our body is equally real. How does the body perceive? It perceives through the sense perceptions. The sense perceptions are actually another cover upon ourselves. The sense perceptions constitute what we call the astral body. The astral body is not a body, it's an experience created by sense perceptions per se. Even if we do not have this physical body, the sensory perceptions continue. And as we will find during the meditation sessions in the next 2 days, you can have all the sense perceptions without the use of this physical body. And I do some experiments with you, scientific experiments, to show you that this is true, that the sense perceptions do not die when this body dies, and therefore they have an independent existence besides this physical body. Indeed, if you are able to experiment with your astral body or the sensory body, you'll find it has a much longer life than this physical body. The physical body, in terms of physical time, only exists for a short period, 50, 60, 100 years, 150 years. It has never gone above that. And that's a very small period compared to the cosmic time created in the material around us, where we say this physical universe that we see has been created 14.5 billion years ago in the Big Bang. And when we talk of billions of years of cosmic time around us, and our body has 100 years life, such a small time. I saw in the National Geographic Museum in Washington, D.C., that they made a big clock to show the birth of this universe at 12 o'clock. I don't know if it was 12 midnight or 12 noon. Must be midnight, because it was very dark when the Big Bang took place. They say it was all dark. So the big clock shows that we did not come into being at 12 o'clock. The universe was created as a single cell, as a single molecule, as a single atom of hydrogen, and gradually developed into helium and hydrogen. The sun which we see today has still not been able to go beyond that, and is a collection of hydrogen and helium after 14.5 billion years after the Big Bang. We also find that on that clock, we go right up to 4 o'clock before even the Earth is born. The Earth is between 3 and 4 o'clock that we see cool down to the level where we are seeing it now. And then upon the Earth comes various kinds of experiments, like 6 million years of rain, so that all the Earth is covered by rain, which was vapor before that. The whole Earth is nothing but ocean. When the ocean is interrupted by volcanic activity of the volcanic energy inside the Earth, land appears. And land has been appearing slowly through volcanic action, but it has taken billions of years for all the land to appear. And the land is still less than 1/3 of the total surface of the Earth. And on this land came various other species of life. And according to that clock, the Earth became habitable for life at 5 o'clock. At 5:15, some of chimpanzees and animals came which were like us according to Darwinian theory of evolution. And at 5:25, man is born. And now we are at 5:27 p.m. If you look at time in that sense, you'll see, what are we talking about, that 100 years of life is much? It's a very small speck. If you really stand on the edge of an ocean beach and see the waves coming in, like a wave comes, throws up an energy and goes away, our life is no more than that. It's like a bubble that rises, looks beautiful in the sun, is colorful, nice, and then it's gone. With such a short life, we are assuming that is the immortal self that we are looking for. Is that what has been described in the scriptures, that we are the immortal beings? Obviously, it is no reference to the physical body, which is so temporary. But if we are able to experiment with the astral body, the sensory body, we'll find it is holding experiences that were there way before we were born. And it can be shown to have experiences that will last in a disembodied state when we have no body, even after we die in the physical body. How do you experiment? We do all the experiments with our physical body here, because that's our only reality at this time. We do not see any other real thing except our physical body and the physical universe around us. How can we experiment with something that happens after death, when we don't have a physical body, but the sensory systems still prevail? Can we double check that they do prevail, first of all? And secondly, how do they function? The method suggested by the practitioners of the spiritual science, say, the method is simple. Try to follow what happens to a person when he dies physically in his body. You will notice, if you have seen a person dying slowly in a hospital, or any time that you have had occasion to see a person dying, you will notice that the person dies first from the extremities of the body. He cannot feel where the hands and the feet are. Gradually, he doesn't know where the legs have gone, where the arms have gone. The torso is still there. And when the torso also disappears from the consciousness of the person, he can still speak. And then the life goes away gradually upwards from the lowest chakras to the top chakra. When the brain is reached, the head is reached and dies, the body is dead. The body dies in stages. And the body dies in stages which can be easily seen. Now, the mystic practice says, the spiritual practice of science says, why not replicate this process without actually dying? Do we have to really die in order to have that experience? Or can we simulate this experience by a practice? So they said that there's a very good practice available to us because of a special talent given to all human beings called the talent of using our attention, human attention. Human attention is that part of consciousness which we can manipulate and direct wherever we like. We can put our attention on one particular thing. We can move our attention. Now, this capacity that human beings have to place their attention where they like. You want to read a book, you can put your attention on the book, and the book becomes intelligible. You want to listen to music, go to a concert, you put your attention on the musicians, on the concert, on the drums and the other instruments, and you pick them up and enjoy them. It is the movement and manipulation of the attention that is giving you all these experiences. Since attention can be moved from one place to another, the spiritual science says, why not withdraw the attention to your own self within the body at one point? Why not withdraw the attention, if you can move it, locate it inside the body at a place which would die last in an actual death of the physical body, and that would be the brain. Why don't we use the power of moving our attention to figure out that we are in the head, we are sitting in the middle of the brain, and draw all the attention there? If we are able to do that, what will happen? Experiment, practice it, do a scientific experiment that if you draw your attention behind the eyes and hold it there, what happens? You will see that soon you will not know where your hands and feet are. Then you won't know where your legs and arms have gone. Then you will know that the torso is also disappearing from your consciousness. Eventually, you'll be released from the experience of the body, and suddenly you'll find you are still there with a different body, with same sense perceptions, stronger sense perceptions than you ever had. This is almost calling, the whole experience can be called dying while living. We are still living, but we're having the same experience we would have if we were to die. And this is a scientific experiment that anybody can do, that you can withdraw your attention behind the eyes into the head and stay there till you become unconscious of this body. If you become unconscious of this body and you still retain consciousness of yourself, obviously there's something more than this body that you can call the self. What next? If the astral body or the sukshma sharir or the fine body, which consists of sense perceptions but does not consist of any matter, if that body functions by itself, can it move around? You'll be shocked to find that body has more mobility than you ever had here. You cannot even obtain that mobility by traveling first class in a plane, which you can do with that body. You can fly where you like. You can fly within this world, you can fly in this universe, you can fly to any galaxy of this universe, you can fly beyond to galaxies not discovered by the science yet. It's one step on the spiritual practice that can lead to this experience. You don't have to depend on somebody else's faith. This is not a faith-based thing, it's a scientific thing. That if you withdraw your attention behind the eyes, you'll get the experience which you will normally get only after the physical body dies. That's not all. You can go further and withdraw your attention within the sensory systems that open up when this body is vacated through these means. And when the sensory systems are vacated by the same process of withdrawing your attention to the center of the head of the sensory system, you'll find even the sensory system disappears. And you are more alive than ever before. You find that your mind, which you were using for thinking, which you were using for communicating, you were using for speaking and writing, that mind is no more than another body covering you, covering the spirit, covering consciousness. And the mind then becomes a causal body, and you discover that everything that you experienced, all life that you experienced in the physical body or in the sensory body, arose from the mind. And truly it has been called the causal body. It's the cause of all experiences. But still it's a body. You can proceed further and leave the causal body in the same way by the use of attention. By withdrawing the attention to the core of the mental body or the causal body, you are able to vacate the causal body and find you were never any of these bodies. You were the spirit. And the spiritual experience has been successful. The science of spirituality has worked. You will notice that the first time you will know who you are, and who you are is immortal. That spirit which was giving power to the mind, that spirit which was giving power the sensory systems. That spirit which was giving power to the physical body, that spirit which was enlightening you to the point of knowing the entire creation at every level. The creation of the physical world by being in the physical cover of this body, an experience of an astral world, a different world, by being in that astral body, an experience of a much larger causal world by being in the causal body, that you were making all these bodies work, that you were generating all these experiences by putting on these different covers upon yourself, and that you were the spirit. Spirituality comes from the spirit, not from the mind, not from the senses, and not from the physical body. That is the spiritual path. Great master used to say, my path starts from the spirit, from Parbrahm, that means beyond the mind. My path itself is starting from the time when you discover the spirit and then find out what is the origin of the spirit. And the origin of the spirit is the totality of the spirit, which is only one. One single consciousness within which the whole drama is taking place. That's our reality. That's our truth. We can call that the ultimate creator, the ultimate God, the ultimate self. But that is our self. The spiritual path is a discovery of that self. So anybody who's telling us different ways of doing things which are only exercise for the body, the mind, or the senses is not really telling us anything spiritual. The science of spirituality goes beyond all these. And therefore, the spiritual path is only really taught by those people who have transcended this body, transcended the senses, transcended the mind, and gone to discover what the spirit is, what pure consciousness is. And they have discovered that pure consciousness is individuated only for an experience, which indeed becomes a separate body. The soul itself can be called a body in the sense that the soul is individuated as if there are many souls, and we have experience of many souls. The souls actually emerge from and are part of a single soul. The single soul is totality of consciousness, which is our reality. Within the totality of consciousness, we experience individuation, and therefore we think there are many souls. So the many souls are not separated. They're within the same consciousness. When I was young and I heard that a comparison was being made between our reality and our individual soul, that the reality was like an ocean. An example was being given that the reality is like a big ocean, and we are like a drop of that ocean, separated from the ocean, suffering the pangs of separation, and the spiritual path consists of returning back to the ocean and merging in it. That did not appeal to me at all. I said, what kind of spiritual path is that? If I am a drop of an ocean, at least I have an identity as a drop of ocean. If I get merged, what will happen? I lose my identity. I lose everything. I am nowhere. And what does the ocean gain by having one more drop in it? Nothing. It's a lose-lose situation for both. I am a loser and the ocean is not a gainer. So what kind of spiritual path is this? But I was wrong. The analogy wasn't correct. This analogy that we are separated from the ocean is not correct. We have never been separated. When I discovered the truth was, indeed I was a drop. But I was a drop that never left the ocean. I was a drop that was still within the ocean. I was a drop that had become a drop, not by separation, but by shrinking of awareness to the point of a drop. That all that I needed to discover the ocean was to expand the awareness to totality, and I'd be the ocean myself again. That made sense to me. That the separation is not really taking you away from the creator. You are part of the creator. You only shrunk your awareness where you think you are just an individual. And the spiritual path is not a journey that you go somewhere to join somebody. The spiritual journey, the spiritual path is to enlarge your awareness, enlarge your consciousness, to discover who you really are, that you are always the totality, and we're experiencing a partial, a point of view of the totality, a partial view, that this is just a partial small view, but we have never left. So that is why the spiritual journey can be misstated as a journey. It's such a small journey. Somebody asked me, how long is the spiritual journey? As if we have to travel somewhere. The reason why they asked me this question was because people travel to places of pilgrimage. They travel to various shrines. They travel to different holy places in order to meet their creator, in order to worship. And they think that you have to make a journey. The journey has always been made by people by traveling, and they thought that the spiritual journey must also be some kind of a travel. It must be a spiritual travel that you have to do. So when they said, how long is the journey? How long is the distance to our destination? It was a tough question for me. I said, it's a very short journey. How short? Is it about a mile or two? No, it's not even a few inches. I was referring to the size of the head. And then they said, from where you are now to where you go, how far is it? I said, actually, the truth is, the distance is zero distance. The rising of consciousness within that zero distance creates the distance of the journey. It's not that we have to travel anywhere. When we experience things around us, does it ever occur to you, if you are driving in a car, is the car moving or is the whole universe around you moving? Has it ever occurred that maybe the car is stationary and it's all the roads are moving around you? Everything else is bypassing you, and therefore you feel there's a movement. All movement we experience in this world is based on relative positions of different things that we experience. If our experience is passing us by, we'll think we are moving. There is a little fun show in Disney World, which I like. They make you sit in a little bus, and then electronically, they produce images and sensory perceptions. The wind is blowing on your face, and on the screen you see that things are moving very fast towards you, and they actually create the impression that you are flying through space. Actually, you're moving nowhere. It's just the experience created by the environment moving around you. Is it possible that this is also happening now? If you are able to study the science of spirituality in its entirety, you'll find that is precisely what is happening. You never move. Everything else moves around you and creates the experience of movement. You never change. It's the change around you that creates the experience of change. This is so remarkable. When do you find that out? You only find when you know who you are. You cannot find it less than that. Because below that, all the experience seems to be consisting of change. All the experience seems to be a movement. So you only discover when you discover who you are, when you are the spirit, that you find out that the entire experience generated by senses, by consciousness, by the body, all these experiences created change and movement because you were still and steady at one location, indeed no location. And all locations were created by the consciousness and created movement and change around you. That is why, how long is the journey? There is no journey. You are exactly at your destination right now. We are at our destination right now. If we were not, this body would dry and crumble. Our mind would die. Everything would die around us. It is by virtue of our being at our destination that makes us conscious, that makes us alive, and makes us have all the experiences of the different covers that we are having upon ourselves. This is indeed a great revelation to us through the science of spirituality, that you can discover your own self, your own truth, and find the answers to every question that has ever arisen about the covers upon ourselves. Every question that you have ever raised about this physical body and life in the physical world, every question you have raised about the sensory systems, every question you ever raised about your mind, what it is, how it functions, are answered by a single experience of discovering who you are. So that is why this spiritual practice is something far more than what we consider it to be. It's not just an experience of having some interesting psychic experiences. When I was at the university at Harvard, Cambridge, they set up a new center called the Yoga Center. It was the design made by two professors of psychology who were then teaching psychology at the university. Those two professors were experimenting on consciousness, experimenting with what they called altered consciousness. They wanted to see if we can alter our state of existing physical consciousness, what happens? And they wanted external aid to do that. They did not use meditation or meditational exercise or practices. They imported some mushrooms from Mexico because those mushrooms were known to have altered states of consciousness of the people in Mexico. And they thought maybe we can experiment what is there in them. So they imported those mushrooms. They worked. They altered their states of consciousness. Then they analyzed the mushrooms and found that there was mescaline in those mushrooms, which they further developed by sending it to a Swiss lab. And this was the birth of the LSD and the DMT and the birth of the new drug age. Those two professors were expelled from the university for these experiments. One was Richard Alpert, and he became Baba Ram Das. He discovered that it was not necessary to go through chemicals to have altered experiences. The true way of finding altered experiences was through meditation. He went to India. He met many masters who were practicing the altered states through meditation, through withdrawing the attention, to moving attention within yourself. And he wrote several interesting books also. The other professor, Timothy Leary, he left and he was expelled from there. He left the country on an island and set up a new church. And he called the church of the boo-hoo. Why did he call that? Because he thought there was not much difference between the sublime and the ridiculous. So that is why he found that if you discover what consciousness is, how it can be altered so easily, you'll discover that we are experimenting with the periphery of spirituality. So these two professors had a yoga center there. And I was a student, and I had three other students from India who were studying there on a fellowship, on a scholarship that we got. And the other three were fond of drinking, dining, wining, womaning, whatever it is called. They were interested in parties of that kind. And I was not interested in that type of life. I had not grown up like that. So they tried to drag me into that life. And I would say, no, 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 I don't want to go to these parties. They said, why, you are afraid. You claim to be a very fearless man. Now the test has come and you have failed. You can't even come to a party. So there was another Pakistani guy who had lived in the university for a long time, who used to host these parties. They have a lot of alcohol, liquor, meats and all kinds of food which I was not accustomed to. And he told these friends of mine, if you bring this guy who pretends to be holier than thou, we'll treat him nicely and we'll break up all these holiness of his. And he'll be like us. I have broken many people who came from overseas as students and made them live a proper life of partying and drinking and all that. So they threw this challenge to me. And I said, no, no, I don't accept these kind of challenges. Then they said, you claim that great master who was your teacher, who gave you all this knowledge, was really a great master. If a great master cannot protect you, what kind of master was he? That you can't even go to a party. When they named the great master, I had no option but to say, I'll go to the party. And I went to the party. In the party, the host decided not to have any vegetarian food and not to have any soft drinks, only alcohol, all liquor and meats, just so that I'll have no option but to drink and eat what they were drinking and eating. So when I reached there, three of the fellows there were from the yoga center who had been practicing altered states of consciousness. So when I sat down, by chance it happened that two of them were sitting next to me, and they began to describe that day's experience with the mushrooms. And they mentioned how the room had become pink and the walls were trying to draw them inside the wall, and they were telling them some unusual experience. So I interfered with their conversation. I interrupted them and I said, then this happens. Then the walls come like this, this color changes like that. So they thought I was in it too. So they said, you too? You too, Brutus? And I said, no, I have never taken any of these mushrooms. I've never taken any of these drugs. And then how do you know all about it? I said, what you're describing is a very simple experience anybody can have by a concentration of attention on the heart chakra. And people are doing it all the time. This is nothing unusual. So they were so surprised by this. They said, you mean to say without drugs you can have the same experience as drugs? So they invited me to address the yoga center next day. It was called, the title of the talk was Turning On Without Drugs. So I told them they can all turn on, and drugs is not necessary. Drugs are chemicals. They're interfering with your normal energy levels, energy usage of energy centers, and you just alter them and you get these experiences. I told them this is not spirituality. Turning on and having an unusual experience, even having an experience of out of body, means nothing. It is just a temporary experience, lower than your wakeful experience. When you finish the experiment and you are awake, you feel this is more real than that. How can that be more real? If this wakeful state is real compared to your altered state, how can the altered state take you to any greater reality? So I mentioned some of these points in my talk to the yoga center, and they were surprised that all that they were experiencing could be done through practice of various kinds of meditations and yoga and so on. It has been done for centuries. So the point I was making is that they were considering that there is something to be done externally to the body, whereas all the experiences can be obtained within yourself through meditation. Meditation is the most powerful art that we have ever discovered in order to discover the highest levels of reality within us. Some people say we read books and they say this world we see is illusion. I said, do you believe it's illusion? I'll just take a little pin and prick you and see if you still call it illusion. There was a guy who came to the Dera of the great master once, and he was talking about his knowledge of Sachkhand, true home, and the highest regions. I said, here's a guy who's come for the first time, he knows all that. But then I found he was fake, and he was just trying to pretend that he was all that he had controlled himself completely, his mind was under control, his soul was under control. So I actually took a pin, a small safety pin, and I opened it up, and I poked it in him. I knew I could run faster than him. I was much younger. I was just a child. When I poked it, he got up and got so angry. He ran after me. I asked him, where are those five kids gone? We call those five kids, those five vices, because it is said that in the spiritual exercise, when you transcend the mind, these anger, lust, greed, they all disappear in the form of little kids walking away. You see them and they say goodbye and walk away. It's just an experience, a spectacle that comes. So I asked him that question because I saw his anger was so strong. And of course, everybody was listening to him left. Point is, how can we call an experience going on as unreal, illusion, when the pain is real, when the suffering is real, the joy is real, the pleasure is real, the experiences are real? How do you call it illusion? I never call it illusion anymore. I call it reality of the physical order, one of the realities. We do not create illusions, we create realities. We create levels of realities, not levels of illusion. At one time, we have one reality. When we go to sleep and have a dream in our sleep, we think it is real. And we create a dream reality. When we wake up, the dream reality becomes dream and is unreal. It is not unreal while we are dreaming. In the same way, this life that we are leading in the physical universe with the physical body is one form of reality. We have taken great pains to make it real. We have taken great pains to hide from ourselves all our higher realities. We have taken great pains to hide from ourselves all the knowledge of the future. We have taken great pains to forget the past, totally forget the past lives and forget most of our past current life. We've taken great pains to make it real. All these are elements that are making our daily life a real life. So this is a reality we live in. So that is why we have to practice in this world in every way as if it is real, including the practice of meditation. If this body were unreal, if this whole experience around us is unreal, what are we practicing with? What is spirituality then? What is meditation then? We are talking of this body as being real. It does not mean that we have really found a reality. There's another reality we'll find when we die. Then the same reality we'll find if we die while living through meditation. So we discover different levels of realities, and we have taken pains to experience every kind of creation. There's a creation, experience of creation. We are experiencing this physical world as an experience of creation. We didn't create in order to feel it's an illusion and a shadow. We created so that we think it's real and experience it as real. So this is a created reality. So the created reality has become more real than ourselves. And so the spiritual path says, discover yourself, you'll find that yourself is the only ultimate reality. All others are created realities. That people say, are the heavens real? Yes, when you are in heaven, they are real. When you go above them, they become unreal. Is the astral plane real? It's very real, much more real than the physical plane. If you go above that, it's as unreal as a dream. So everything becomes like a dream, like it's a dream-like creation when you see it from one step above. It's reality when you're within that state. So it's a reality while we are in the physical world, in the physical body. This is our only reality. Not only is it real for us, it's our only reality. We do not have anything else. If we believe that there is a higher reality, that there are heavens, that there are higher levels of consciousness, they are only our imagination. They are only part of our conjecture that they are there. But what pinches us, what pricks us with a little needle, is this physical body and the physical world around us. We are affected by the physical world. Even with the knowledge that you have a higher state of consciousness available to you, even with the conviction that there are higher states of consciousness where you can go, this remains the reality. It's just like a person who gets to know what is going to happen and he thinks he can avoid it, he cannot avoid it. So free will becomes real so long as he doesn't know what's going to happen. We all have free will. Why do we have free will? Because we don't know what the next moment is. Supposing we came to know that the next moment is already there and see it, free will disappear immediately. You will find that you are acting exactly according to the script that you created for yourself, for this destiny. All these methods of sustaining reality at any level have been created to make the experience of all realities enjoyable. We wanted to make the experience of a creation great for ourselves. The experience became great, but it had a little drawback. The drawback was that in order to create a great experience, we had to create something that was not great. Otherwise, the great experience wouldn't become great. In order to create an experience of pleasure and to know what pleasure is, we had to create an experience of pain. If you don't have the opposite, you don't experience it. In order to see this light, we had to create darkness. Imagine if this light that is here, which we are seeing, were always there. Day and night, you close your eyes, you see the same light. You open your eyes, you see the same light. Do you know what would have happened? You would never have seen the light. Because the only way we know there is light is because we also experience darkness. Carefully examine this. You will find all experiences of ours are based upon the principle of pairs of opposites, based upon the principle of duality. If there is no pair of opposite, we do not experience it. It disappears from experience. So that is why, if you notice, right from the material creation of atoms, protons, neutrons, electrons, right from that particle science up to the levels of consciousness that you can examine, everything has been placed in pairs of opposites. And it's the opposites that is creating the experience of both sides. So we have taken care to create both in order to make it a reality. But why did we want a real universe? For adventure, for fun. We thought it would be great to have a wonderful illusion made turn into a reality, which we can then personally experience. And we should make the adventure huge, large. It should be a big carnival, not a small Disney World or something, but a big Disney World in which we should come and have fun and have rides and things like that, and also have some pain and suffering too, in order to know that there is pleasure and happiness. We set it all up. Then what happened? What happened to our adventure? What happened to the fact that we did all this for adventure and fun? We don't seem to be having fun. We have taken this show to be only the only reality, and nothing else is possible, and that therefore we are trapped, that we are in a big trap. Of course, we created the trap for ourselves, and we didn't create one trap, we created trap after trap and put cage into each cage and have placed ourselves in a position where we now can't even have fun. We are losing our sense of fun because the suffering seems to be overtaking even the fun part. If you look at your life carefully and look at all the events of life, you'll find many of them were good, some were bad, many of them were happy, some were sad, many were plus, many were minus. If you see objectively, they're virtually well balanced, the plus and minus. But the minus looks longer and bigger than the plus. The reason being that a new element was introduced into all this experience called the element of time. And time is the greatest trap of all, because time placed all events at different positions and changed everything. By time, we were able to divide the experience into pain and pleasure at separate times, that we could have a very good pleasurable moment and then we could have a sad moment. And the two got separated by the creation of time. Then what else did time do? It treated the two types of experiences differently in terms of subjective experience. If we had a painful moment, it looked much longer than if we had a pleasurable moment. If you had 5 minutes of pleasure and 5 minutes of pain, the 5 minutes of pleasure disappear like 1 minute, and the 5 minutes of pain look like 5 hours. So therefore, subjectively, we converted a world in which we had created balance in the pair of opposites, a balance in duality, into one where the pain has overtaken the pleasure and unhappiness has overtaken the happiness because of the time factor, and time moves slowly. Oscar Wilde, in his essay on suffering, opens the essay by this sentence: suffering is one long moment. When a moment does not pass, it's suffering. So suffering is not based upon what's happening, it's the extension in subjective time. We feel it's longer. The clock doesn't say it's longer. The watches won't say it's longer. We'll feel it's longer. And therefore, a world that was created for us to have an adventure has suddenly turned out to be a world of unhappiness and pain, more than happiness and pleasure. How do we reverse this? By discovery of the nature of the creation, by discovery how we created all this, how we are part of it. And that is done through the practice of the science of spirituality, through meditation and meditational practices. Now we will be dealing with this subject in a practical way in the next 2 days. And I have been always saying that the spiritual path is not a path merely of philosophy or of high-sounding words or of high-sounding ideas. It's something that we have to personally experience. If you do not personally experience what we talk about here, you are nowhere understanding the spiritual path. The spiritual path is best understood by personal experience and personal practice, because there are so many experiences lying ahead in our spiritual path which cannot be explained by logic, which do not follow the laws of logic, which are inconsistent with the laws of logic, and yet they are real. And those experiences can only be described as an experience that you have. It's a personal experience you have. You can try to describe it, but defies even description. So when these kind of experiences lie in our reality, in our higher realities, the only way to know them is to experience them, to go there, to have it. So that is why our talks and our lectures have no meaning unless they are followed up with the practice of what we talk. And so you might, some of you think I just do the talk here. No, I do the walk also. Not only talk the talk, but do the walk the walk. Tomorrow is walk the walk. So I'm glad that so many of my friends have come from very far off places, I notice. And I'm very happy to see all of you. And I'll be working with you the next 2 days in experimenting on what we've just been talking about. That means practice, and practice as much as you can during a workshop of this kind, because when you go away from here, there's so many distractions in life, so many other things that take you away, and therefore you lose the momentum which can be created by practicing here. So you have to regenerate this experience by a constant meeting of this kind. It is not necessary to hear things over and over again, but our mind is forgetful and we slip away from our, even from our promises that we will do this, and we go away and we forget about them. So that is why it's good to practice something here and then carry it with you. And if you are able to achieve some of these experiences while you are here, it is not easy to forget them because they are unforgettable experiences. I'm hoping to see many of you have those experiences in the next 2 days. So welcome to this meditation workshop, and I'll see you tomorrow. Thank you.